I'm Joshua Bardwell, and today you're going to learn about the Betaflight F3 flight controller. This is the flight controller that was developed in cooperation with Boris B., the father of Betaflight. And many of you have been holding off on buying this controller until you saw my review of it. And I'm sorry it took me so long to get around to it. I've been super busy. Go check my video history. But here it is. I'm going to give you the information I hope that you'll need in order to figure out if this is the right flight controller for you. So let's just do a quick rundown of this board. It's an F3 flight controller. It's got a PDB built in. It's got the Betaflight OSD built in. And it's got an SD card reader built in. It's got a regulator, internal regulator. It takes 2 to 6S power. And it has a 3 amp 5 volt regulator. Now that right there is going to make or break the board for some of you. Some of you are going to look at those features and go, those are not the features that I want. For example, a board with a built-in PDB may not be right for your build. If you've got a particular OSD and PDB that you love, like the RROSD, for example, you may not want a flight controller with a built-in PDB. Another thing that might make a difference for some of you is that flight controllers with integrated PDBs, like this one, are not ideal for use with 4-in-1 ESCs, at least if you want current reading, in other words, amps and milliamp hours. And the reason for that is that in order to get the current reading, the current has to flow through this shunt resistor. And what that means is that the current has to come in from the main battery discharge leader on this pad and go out to the ESC pads at the edges of the board. So if you want to use this board with a 4-in-1 ESC like this one, what you would need to do is you need to wire your battery here, and then you need to wire from the ESC pad over to the battery lead on the 4-in-1 ESC. And here's the problem with that. These pads at the edge of the board are designed for individual ESCs. They're rated for, on this particular board, they're rated for, I think, 25 amps continuous and something like 30 or 40 amps burst. So if you run all 4 ESCs off of one of these pads, you'll exceed the current rating, you'll overheat it, and you'll damage the board. What you could theoretically do is run a wire from each of these pads all over to here, but what a freaking mess that would be. So the bottom line is, if you're going to use a board like this with a built-in PDB, then either you give up the current reading, you just expect that it won't work, and then what you would do is you would wire the battery to here, and then you would just put a separate VBAT wire over to here, and it would just power the flight controller, and you wouldn't wire the ESCs to here, they would just be on your 4-in-1. But then you wouldn't get the current reading. And at that point, you might be better off just choosing a different flight controller that didn't have the PDB built in. So that's a factor that's going to affect some of your purchasing decisions. If you're going to be using... I already said that part. So those are some factors that will affect your purchasing decisions. I've often told people who say, well, just sum it up for me. What flight controller should I get? And I say, if you want a flight controller with the PDB built in, this is the one I recommend. Oops, I should have waited till the end of the video to say that, and then you would all stick around. Now you're all going to tune out. Don't tune out. I have more to say. Of course I do. The board has an F3. And some of you are saying, well, why didn't you put an F4 on it? In this day and age, shouldn't we future-proof by putting an F4 on it? And that assumes that there's no downsides to an F4. An F4 is a physically larger chip, and there are some intricacies of getting it to work with, for example, smart port telemetry and telemetry inversion on the UARTs and so on and so on. The bottom line is that an F3 today is going to run Betaflight as fast as Betaflight can run. The fastest Betaflight will run is 8 kHz gyro and 8 kHz PID loop. And with Betaflight 3.1, I can do that right now at like 30% processor utilization on an F3. So you have plenty of buffers. You have at least a little bit of buffer space for new features, for additional stuff like LED strip and so forth and so forth. If you run very processor heavy stuff, then you may hit the limits of an F3, and this board may not be for you. So let's take a look at some of the things I do like about this board and some of the things that might motivate you to choose this board over some others. One of the things I love about this board is that this is such a small thing, but it's got a bootloader button, and the bootloader button is on the edge of the board. I feel like this is a really small design touch that really shows that the designer is thinking. I hate it when designers put the bootloader button somewhere on the inside of the board, because how are you going to get at it if it's in your copter? You can't really get in there. You don't want to stick a screwdriver or something in there to get at the bootloader button and accidentally short something. It's no good. Putting it on the edge of the board shows that the designer was really thinking about usability. More and more, we don't have to push the bootloader button, especially if you're using Betaflight, because Betaflight has a command line command, DFU. You type DFU at the command line, the board reboots into bootloader mode. You don't have to touch the button. That's a very nice thing for those of us who don't have a bootloader button on our flight controller and might have pads or something like that that it's much harder to work with. Now, this board is a dual-layer board, and most boards that we've worked with are dual-layer boards, but generally the designers will try to put all the relevant pads on the top. And basically the bottom of the board is not used very much. This board uses both the top and the bottom. So if we look at the main battery pads, the ground is on the top and the positive is on the bottom. So in other words, the battery leads are going to come in and they're going to sandwich the board like that. They're not going to go side by side. That's just to make the best use of space. If we look at the motor headers, we can see that the ground and the signal are on top and the positive and the negative are on bottom. Now that's going to add some complication to how you wire up the board, because if you think about it, You would install the board on the copter, and then you would solder up your ESCs, and you cut your wires to length, solder them up, and you'd be good to go. If you do that with this board, well, you can't solder the bottom of the board, right? Obviously, and if you solder it with the board upside down, then how are you going to flip it over to put the motors on and everything? So I think the best way to install this board is going to be to cut your ESC wires to length, or if your ESCs didn't come naked, desolder the ESC wires from the ESCs. Flip the board over, solder all the wires to the ESC pads on the board, then flip the board back over and install it in the copter, and then solder them back onto the ESCs. It does make maintenance a little bit of a hassle. Let's now take a look at these pinouts here. Now these are labeled, they're silkscreened on the bottom of the board. So again, I find it really, I know why they do this. I actually don't know why they do this. Why do manufacturers put the silkscreen, or designers put the silkscreen on the bottom of the board? You have just as much room on top to put the silkscreen on top, but they never do, and I don't know why. It makes wiring up the board so much more complicated, because you either have to solder all the wires onto the bottom and then install the board in the copter, which is a hassle, or you have to put the board in the copter face up, and then you have to kind of guess and hope and read the pinout diagram and cross your fingers and hope you didn't screw it up. What a hassle. I wish they would put the silkscreen on the top, and I honestly don't know why they don't do it. If we go ahead and look at the bottom of the board, though, let's see what we've got here. Well, first of all, this is our receiver connection here, and you'll see it says S-Bus or DSM. That's a spectrum satellite. So any serial receiver will get plugged in here. The main difference between most serial receivers and the odd man out is the spectrum satellite. The difference is that spectrum satellite receivers take 3.3 volts, and everybody else takes 5 volts. If you feed 5 volts into a spectrum, you'll destroy it. And the way you choose what you're going to get here is with this solder bridge right here. So you got 5 volts here and 3 volts there. You can see they're labeled. And you'll put a little blob of solder that will either bridge 5 volts to the center or 3 volts to the center. And that'll choose which of those you're going to feed to the receiver. Most of you are going to choose 5 volts. These are pretty tiny solder pads, and you may think they're a little hard to solder. But the good news is you're not actually soldering a wire to them. And if you bridge the pads, that's actually what you're supposed to do. Normally, that's a mistake. So you just got to get in there with a little bit of I like a little chisel tip soldering iron. I'll bridge both of the pads with the tip, and then I'll just feed some just enough solder in that it blobs between them. Moving up to the top of the board here, we've got the video pads. There's video out and video in for your camera and for your video transmitter. And this pad is labeled RAM. So what is RAM? I actually don't know what RAM stands for. The first time I saw RAM was on the Omnibus series, and maybe before that it was somewhere else, I don't know. But the idea here is that your video transmitter and your camera get their own power bus, and you can feed them a separate voltage from the rest of the board. And then you just have a convenient header here that you can run them to, but they get their own voltage. And the voltage they get is decided right here. It can be either 5 volts or VBAT. The recommendation from FPV Model is if you run 5 volts to the RAM pad, then only run your camera off RAM. Do not run your video transmitter as well. And the reason for that, well, first of all, many video transmitters will not take 5 volts. They just don't run. They need at least like 7 volts to run. So if that's the case, you have no choice but to use VBAT. But even if your video transmitter can run off of 5 volts, it'll probably draw a lot of current. And even though this is a fairly beefy regulator, I think it's rated for 3 amps, the idea is that you may pull an amp or more if you're running your video transmitter at 5 volts and just not have enough headroom to really make the copter run well. So the recommended practice is to run the RAM bus off of VBAT, and you want to confirm that your video transmitter and your camera are okay with whatever battery voltage you're running. I wonder whether a RAM bus is filtered when you run off of VBAT. Usually the way that designers will filter the power to the video components is that they'll put it on a regulator. Then they may also have additional, like an LC filter or something. But a lot of times, the regulator itself is sufficient filtering. In this case, I wonder whether if you're running off of VBAT, whether you've got filtering to those components or not. Don't know the answer to that. The ground pad here is labeled AGND, A ground. And the idea here, again, is that especially with video components, you need the electrical system, the grounding, etc., to be right. You want the camera and the video transmitter both to be wired to this same ground pad. Otherwise, you can get ground loop or ground reference issues, and that'll manifest as noise in your video. So both the camera and the video transmitter need to be wired back to this AGND pad. That's essential for best video performance. Let's not forget that if you want to, you certainly could get power for your video transmitter and your camera from somewhere else. A PDB with a voltage regulator, really anything, any number of ways to solve that problem. The video out and video in have to be used in order for the OSD to work, but you can take your power and your ground from somewhere else if you so desire. The ground should always be wired back to wherever the power is coming from, though. That's critical. The next row down, I'm very happy to see. It is soft serial. You see it says soft SIR here, and there's the RX, the TX, and the RX pad. It's very nice that they've broken out a soft serial pad here for those who need just one more UART for something, but the board doesn't have a spare UART to give. A lot of boards, when we went to F1 boards, had two UARTs that we got access to, which was not enough for many of the things, the peripherals, the OSDs, and so on, that we wanted to run. And that's especially true now that we're all using serial receivers. Back when we were using PPM receivers, you had two UARTs, and they weren't being used for anything. One was being used for USB, the other one was free. But now that we're all using serial receivers, we're taking up a UART with the serial receiver, and so we have fewer usable UARTs than we used to. So having accessible smart soft serial gives you a little bit more options for serial connectivity. It's very nice that that's broken out here on the board. If we look here at the side of the board, we've got UART 1 and UART 3 broken out, and then UART 2 is broken out right here. So there's all three of the UARTs that we would use. One of those UARTs is going to be mapped to the serial receiver. I don't know which one. I'm going to guess that it's UART 2, and that's why UART 2 is put in the same header here. So the idea, I suppose, is that you'll use either the serial receiver here, or you can use UART 2 if you're not using a serial receiver. If you're not using a serial receiver, then you're probably using a PPM receiver, and in that case, this is the header that you would use. Here's ground, 5 volts, and the PPM input. Here's the SD card. Here's the SD card slot on this board, and it has been a topic of some discussion. The problem is that it's just a little stubby length, and of course they did that so they could fit this inductor here for the voltage regulator, so I get it. But the problem is that when you insert the card, it's barely held in there at all, and people have reported that the card comes out in a crash. I don't know what a good solution to this is. Obviously, you can't just tape the card in there, and one reason for that is that if you were to run like a piece of tape or a piece of Velcro, you'd cover up the USB port. Maybe the answer is to put some kind of like Velcro over the board, like a Velcro strip, and it covers the USB port, and then when you need to get, how often do you get at the USB, really? I don't know. When you need to get at the USB or take the card out, you move the Velcro out of the way. I don't know. But this is if there's a sort of a shortcoming in this board, I would say that this SD card reader, despite the fact that I understand why they did it, that certainly might be the shortcoming in the board. Well, all right, there's your look at the Betaflight F3 flight controller from FPV Model. On paper, the specs of this board are perfect, and the reputation of the people who developed it is very good. If this board looks like it suits the bill for you, I don't think you should hesitate to buy it. If you can find it in stock. I hope you enjoyed this review. I hope you found it informative. And as always, happy flying.